Hello guys. Today we are going to take again a very interesting integrated lecture upon the rhino-orbital mucor mycosis. So we have our ENT faculty, Dr. Sanjay. Welcome, sir. And today we will be having a great insight because, you know, mucor mycosis is talk of the town. So we thought, why not talking about the integrated aspect, because mostly the patients are presenting with the sinusitis. I think, what do you say, sir? Please throw some insight on this.
In mucor mycosis, you're right that the first thing that the patient comes with is nasal problems. And a very simple rhinosinusitis is the main presentation. And that's why it is a misleading thing. Because we tend to think that it's a nasal blockage, nasal discharge. And if you don't do a proper examination, it tends to get ignored. And when the patient comes back again, it's more serious. And this is when it tends to spread to the orbit and the cranial cavity. And that's why orbital spread has become so common. And that's why we have decided to take this topic of rhino-orbital, you know, mucor mycosis as a topic. Precisely.
Yes. Yes, sir. So please, sir, can show us some presentation that how will this patient present and how do we actually get to know suspicion that this patient can be having mucor mycosis?
So, Dr. Neha, this is the main presentation from the ENT point of view. If you look at the first line, it says black nasal discharge. Now, the moment a patient who have had COVID and on steroids, or even without COVID and steroid patient on diabetic, uncontrolled diabetic, the moment they have this black color nasal discharge, this should ring your bell in your minds that is it mucor mycosis? Because it's pretty, in India, it's a pretty common disease. Now, why is it common in India? For two reasons. A, you know that India is a diabetic capital of the world. And so many people going around with diabetes, and we all know the attitude in India, it's chalta hawala attitude, you know? People do take, maybe they are taking treatment from the respective physician, but we all know nobody really takes it, you know, properly. The compliance is not really good. And therefore, the control of the sugar in most cases is not adequate. They may be taking medicines off and on, and they don't bother to check their glucose, sugar glucose. And in most of the cases, you see more often than not, that the sugar level is not controlled. And that's why the immunity is always low. And we all know mucor mycosis is an opportunistic pathogen, fungus, and therefore it strikes this patient who are immunocompetent, the immunity is less because of diabetes. Now here, if the patient is COVID, and we all know COVID patients are, most of them are receiving steroid also. Now steroid is like a, you know, karele pe neem chada. It's twice as bad. Patient is already diabetic, and steroid even worsens the diabetes, makes the immunity even lesser. And even otherwise, steroid on its own is also going to decrease the immunity. And that's why it tends to infect, decrease the immunity. And these are the patients who are liable to get this disease in most cases. Now, when the patient comes with this black nasal discharge, now, as I said, this will very easily ring a bell in the physician's mind or the surgeon's mind. And then the patient gets investigated proper, diagnosed at time, and maybe treated properly. But the problems are the patients who do not have this black discharge or black patch on the skin, who present a simple rhinosinusitis, like nasal blockade, nasal discharge, very, very common in the initial stages. Now, these are the risky ones because, you know, we tend to think the rhinitis is Jehovah, you know, and we tend to ignore and we don't investigate as thoroughly as we should. And then this patient go home taking simple anti-allergic treatment, maybe antibiotics and all that. But see, the fungus is still there. The patient has not got proper treatment. And this fungal is going to flare up. And when the patient comes for follow-up next week, by now, the fungus will definitely have crossed the boundaries of the nose and the sinuses, may have entered the orbit and the cranial cavities. This is where things start becoming serious. And that's why it is always, especially in today's time, it is always better that the index of suspicion should be very, very high in all these patients. Any patient who is diabetic, who have had COVID, who is on steroids, the moment they have any of these simple, even simple nasal symptoms, you should suspect this and properly investigate so that you can diagnose at an early stage and prevent serious complication and potential death also. So black nasal discharge is a, you know, it's like a warning signal in most cases when they come. Nowadays, most of these patients, even common people, a general public knows that mucormycosis is a bad disease and it's called black fungus four. Although that's not a right tag, but still people know it as black fungus. And so the moment the patient has black color nasal discharge, they themselves will come back, because most of the patients.
Sir, sorry to interrupt you. Can we have this black nasal discharge anywhere else also, means anything that can be put into the DDs here?
Yeah, black nasal discharge from the nose is the only other important disease that causes black nasal discharge are there's a disease called T-cell lymphoma. Okay. It's a cancer, it's a malignant disease. So malignancies are the only other important disease from the nose. Dr. Neha, I'll tell you one thing.
Yeah.
This disease is not a new disease.
Yes.
I've been teaching for, two decades now. And in all my lectures, all my videos, all my classes, you'll see that I teach this disease every time.
Yes.
Because it's a common disease. But the thing is that I was telling in the last video also that till, say, about January, I used to see only 3 to 4 cases of mucormycosis very commonly in my OPDs. And now in the last 2 months, I've seen more than that. Just in 2 months, I've seen a number of cases more than what I used to see in the entire year. So that's the implication.
It means like lymphoma is not that common. So if a person is coming with the black nasal discharge, means we should first think about the mucormycosis unless it is ruled out.
No, T-cell lymphoma is an extremely rare condition. Extremely rare.
Very
rare. Hardly ever seen. You can say that in my entire career, I may have seen just 1 or 2 cases of T-cell lymphoma. It's that rare. But now this has become very, very important. In fact, we always say this, that if you get a question in the exam, which says a young diabetic with black nasal discharge, the first thing, the only thing that should come to your mind is mucormycosis.
Mucormycosis. Yes. Okay. Yes.
But look at the other symptoms, like this can cause black. Look at the second line, black colored nasal tissue and black skin patches. And because everything is black, that's why the name of the disease, why is disease called black fungus? Commonly because of this black discharge, black. Now, why is it black? The fungus is not black. That's why the name is a misnomer. It's not a fungus, is not black.
Yeah.
It causes the tissue to turn black. And this is because of necrosis. So mucormycosis is a necrotizing disease. It causes necrosis. And why does it cause necrosis? This is a very, very important point. This is a very important MCQ also. Why does mucormycosis cause necrosis and therefore black discharge, black skin, black patches and all that thing? And therefore, it's called the black disease also because of its very important property, which is called angioinvasive.
Yes.
It's an angioinvasive fungus, which means that it invades the blood vessels, especially the arteries and arterioles. And because it invades the arteries and arterioles, it may block the blood vessels, capillaries. And you know that if the blood vessels, capillaries gets blocked, then the blood supply gets cut off. That causes ischemia. And ischemia for long duration causes necrosis. And this is the main reason why so many patients of these have necrosis. The fact that it is an angioinvasive fungus. Now, this term is an MCQ. Please remember this word, angioinvasive. This term is an MCQ. So don't forget, this is a very, very important term. Because we all feel that we are definitely going to get at least 1, maybe 2 questions from mucormycosis this time. Now.
Yes, sir.
And then other symptoms like epistaxis, nasal bleed, facial pain, very, very common. This is a very common symptom. Again, it's so common in this patient. But again, if the patient only comes with facial pain, again, you are not going to suspect mucormycosis. So once again, patient diabetic, patient COVID, patient on steroid, in this time especially, has facial pain, pain around the nose and the sinuses, you should suspect a mucormycosis and investigate properly. Then when it goes to the orbit, then all this starts, which Dr. Neha will talk more detail, periorbital redness and swellings, cheek swellings also from the maxilla and from the orbit also. Now, when the muscles of the orbit gets involved, when it goes inside the orbital cavity, then you have this muscle involvement and ophthalmoplasia leading to diplopia. Diplopia is a main symptom. And in severe cases, it can cause loss of vision. And long duration fever is another very, very important thing. So the key here is, the first presentation is going to be simple nasal blockage, nasal discharge, facial pain. And a patient of COVID on steroid, uncontrolled diabetic, having any of the symptoms, you should consider mucormycosis as one of the diagnoses. Right. Now, how do you confirm? These are some of the pictures, images we are going to show you where the orbit is involved. Look at the patch around the orbit. And they have terms, we'll talk about those. See, the entire cheek has got involved. And this is what we mean when we say it's a highly necrotizing disease and can involve. Now, this is the endoscopic finding of the black turbinate. This is a black color turbinate. And again, because of the, this is a very common finding in the early stage of mucormycosis. This is a very early stage. All these images that I've shown, these are the late stage finding. These are very, very early stage finding. If you suspect a mucormycosis, do endoscopy at a very early stage, then these are the kind of findings that can lead you to the diagnosis of the disease. Now, what are the main things that we do to investigate? See, you have to confirm COVID in today's time, because most of these patients are COVID. Most of these patients are already proven COVID. Mm-hmm. Their tests are positive. And so we don't have to do in most cases. Now, from the ENT point of view, rhinoscopy is a first thing that we do. The first thing, we pick up the Thudicum anti-rhinoscopy mirror, this speculum, and we just look into the nasal cavity. So the things that we are trying to look at are the mucosa lining of the nasal cavity and the turbinates. And especially you are looking at the color of the turbinate. Now, they may not look as black as I've shown you, but slightly change from the normal pinkish nasal mucosa towards blue, blackish. When it's turning from pink to black, initially it is grayish in color, grayish, maybe bluish. So that normal change, the change from the normal color towards black, maybe gray or blue, should raise a suspicion that it could be a mucormycosis. And therefore, you have to further investigate, which Dr. Neha is going to talk about. Then, of course, now CT scan MRI, gadolinium MRI, is a very, very important thing. Why is MRI important? I want to show you this image. Now, look at this CT scan, especially of the paranasal sinuses. Now, look at this side behind the maxilla, this area that I'm pointing. This area behind the maxilla is clean. There's no disease here. But look at the other side, which is involved. This is all mucormycosis in the maxilla. And look behind, this area is entirely involved by the disease. Right. So, these are the areas that we are going to look for, because one of the important things in the treatment is complete debridement of the involved tissue. You have to remove everything, everything. If you leave some tissue behind, then it is going to flare up again and the patient is going to land up in serious problem. So the hidden areas basically can only be seen on scans, CT scan, MRI, and all that. Now the other investigations are nasal endoscopy. I've shown you in the nasal endoscopy, this is to see the deeper area, deeper tissues. When you do anti-rhinoscopy with the Thudicum or maybe Cottles also, you can only see the inferior turbinate, maybe middle turbinate, and the anterior part of the nasal cavity. If you want to look deep into the nasal cavity, superior meatus, superior turbinate, and the posterior nares, maybe nasopharynx also, then of course endoscopy is the most important thing. And how do you confirm? You confirm with the help of biopsy and the staining. We have a lot of stains, and all this Dr. Neha is going to talk more about. So Dr. Neha, on to you.
Thank you so much, sir. Sir, can you tell me one thing, like students have to do the MCQ. So which sinus, in the order of the frequency, which sinus will be the most common one if they ask you the first most common sinus to be involved here?
The two most important sinuses are maxilla and the ethmoidal sinus.
So what?
In that order, maxilla is the most common.
Maxillary sinus is the most common, followed by the ethmoid sinus, right, sir?
Exactly. Yeah.
Okay, sir. So thank you, sir. Let's see the ocular involvement. All right. So see, you have already seen, sir has given you a beautiful picture that how these kind of patients are going to present, and mostly they are going to present with the sinusitis. And now you already know that maxillary sinusitis is the most common presentation, followed by the ethmoidal sinusitis. So mostly what happens, these kind of patients are the referrals from the ENT personnel to us when they are going into the complications. And as the name is also the rhino-orbito-cerebral mucormycosis, so probably this is actually the route through which they are going and following the complications. So you all have the insight now that how they are going to present. We have the nasal discharge, we have nasal stuffiness, and a very important thing that will help you in solving the questions also, a black color discharge. So other thing that sir has told that we also have this in the lymphoma, T-cell lymphoma, and that is quite rare. So if you have a COVID patient, if you have a patient with diabetes, with ketoacidosis, and there are so many risk factors that you already know, like we have neutropenia, we have iron overload patients, we have got patients who are on immunosuppressives, steroids, hematological malignancy, solid organ transplant. So whenever, immunocompromised state is there. So we all know that what are the immunocompromised states, even the patients who have the probability of the iron overload in the hemodialysis, hemochromatosis, or patients of neutropenia. That is again a very, very important risk factor. They even say that HIV, per se is not an independent risk factor. If I'm getting these kind of infections in a HIV patient, then I have some other risk factor also along with that, because HIV is mainly affecting the lymphocytes, so neutrophils are spared there. So usually I have a picture of the acute ethmoidal sinusitis with the blackish discharge. We have stuffiness. We have got black color mucosa. You know about the angioinvasion. So these patients are also having the general features. So they have got a high grade fever with chills and rigors. And usually the background from your referral also, that how did this patient presented. You already know that maybe this patient is COVID positive, and now he is presenting with the signs like orbital cellulitis. So literally speaking, the first presentation, how that patient will go present to me is a case of orbital cellulitis. So with this orbital cellulitis, what are the things that you can have? You will have the blackish discoloration that is very, very typically called as the ishkar formation. So, and due to this ishkar formation only, the black fungus name has come, though it's not the black fungus per se. So we have got the pain. We can have pain in the orbital area, the periorbital area, and that mucosal crusting is very, very typical. And if you are getting that blackish areas, always think about the mucormycosis. So that is very, very evident in cases of your nasal mucosa, even the skin areas. It could be present on the heart palate also. And all this is taking place due to the thrombosis of the vessels as well as tissue necrosis. Now, this I told you before also, that though ishkar formation is very, very pathognomonic of this mucormycosis, but it is not a consistent finding. So it can be a late finding. It can be an inconsistent finding also. Then the problem is that it is going inside. Now, when it is going inside, it is causing the angioinvasion and it is reaching even up to the apex of the orbit. And that is actually the point from where it can gain entry to the brain also and can invite the cerebral complications. So when it reaches this orbital apex, we have got that optic canal there. We have the superior orbital fissure. And that is the hub of nerves. So the optic nerve can be affected. We have got three important nerves which are supplying the extra ocular muscles. We have third nerve, fourth nerve, sixth nerve, and then we also have the fifth nerve. And that is the reason that it is presenting with the acute orbital cellulitis. It can also present with a cavernous sinus thrombosis. So if a patient is having the acute ethmoidal sinusitis, there are chances that it can spread through the cribriform plate of ethmoid, and it is reaching the brain, it is reaching the cavernous sinus. So one of the presentation that you can keep in mind is also a cavernous sinus thrombosis. At times there could be the CRAO, at times it could be painless also, it can be presenting as the orbital apex syndrome, and at times it is just presenting as an acute orbital cellulitis. So you have to keep your horizon wide. You cannot just say that it will present just as orbital cellulitis. It depends upon the patient, how this patient is going to present, but you know that what are the things, what are the spectrum of the things that can be presented in this form. Then the patient sometimes is having very, very severe disease, and obviously it is occurring when the disease has progressed towards the cerebral mode. So if the patient has got the cerebral involvement, then we are going to get the cerebral infarction, intracranial aneurysms, we have hemorrhages, fungal meningitis, and even the mycotic abscess and death. So one of the reasons for the death of the patients in cases of this rhinoorbital mucormycosis could be the cerebral involvement, and rather it's a bad prognostic factor. If we have involvement of the brain, then surely, the patient prognosis is not that good. And we are getting a lot of changes in the mental status. So what are the poor prognostic factors in the CNS involvement? We will have the somnolence, we have coma, disorientation, emotional lability, hemiparesis and hemiplegia. So I think there is a scope that you get a integrated question on this topic, because we have ENT involvement here, we have ocular involvement, we have psychiatric involvement, and we also have the medicine involvement. And plus, already this patient is COVID positive. Already this patient most of the times is diabetic with a ketotic coma. So there are lot many things that could be asked. So if you see the scope of asking the question, so it's very, very high. And these are the images. Now you look in the these images, we have got four images, A, B, C, D here. So look at the image number one. This is a photograph of a patient where you can see the eschar formation in the left eye. And there are, you know, complete destruction of the tissue. The problem is that this is causing angioinvasion, as sir has already mentioned this. So you cannot see any eyelids, you cannot see ocular structures. Now look at this image number B. This is your image number B, which is a T1 image MRI, and you can see that even the globe is not visualized. You can see a mass here, which is an isointense mass in the orbit, and sometimes it is also extending through the superior orbital fissure, and that is the entry where it is taking into the cavernous sinus, and that is the reason why it can present as cavernous sinus thrombosis. Now look at the picture number C. This is actually the T2 section, and this is taken as a coronal section through the maxillary sinus, as sir has told that maxillary sinus involvement is the most common one. So there is, you can see we have got mucosal thickening, we have got opacification, and then finally we have got this D1. This is your T2 image through the orbit, and here you can see the thickening of the extraocular muscles, we can see the mass infiltrating, and we have got these signs both in the intraconal space as well as extraconal space. So basically you have to remember the angioinvasion, the black color mass, the necrosis, the scar formation, and the involvement of the sinuses to the orbit, to the orbital apex, to the cavernous sinus, and to the brain. So these are the five things in this order which you have to remember. So this patient is a patient who is having the fungal orbital cellulitis along with the orbital apex syndrome. Now, why it is important to see whether this patient is presenting as CRAO, whether this patient is presenting as cavernous sinus thrombosis, or whether this patient is presenting with the orbital apex syndrome, because the involvement of optic nerve makes a whole lot of difference. If the patient is having orbital apex syndrome, I can have the involvement of optic canal, I can have involvement of optic nerve. Then surely this patient is going to present with the diminution of vision. But if the patient is coming just with the cavernous sinus thrombosis, I will have a whole lot of clinical features. I will have fever with chills and rigors, diplopia in the lateral gaze, I will have ophthalmoplegia, chemosis, proptosis, a whole lot of features, but I will not have diminution of vision. So again, that makes an important aspect. Then we will have the complete ptosis also, because third nerve is also supplying the LPS. And I hope you know what is chemosis. Guys, always remember chemosis is actually the edema of conjunctiva, so don't confuse it with the congestion, right? So what are the features which are associated with the poorer prognosis? So again, an important thing that could be asked in the question, because you know you have to solve the MCQ, so definitely you will have to see that what are the things that could be asked as an MCQ. So what are the poor prognostic factors? So whenever we have periorbital necrosis, we have cavernous sinus thrombosis, and we have hemiplegia. So whenever the patients are presenting with these three features, you have to be very, very careful, and alarming signal has to be given to the doctors as well as to the attendants that the patient is serious and it's a poor prognostic factor. Now, periorbital mucormycosis, we know, is very, very invasive disease, and whole lot of characteristic is actually dependent upon its angioinvasiveness. So not only it's involving your cutaneous tissues, the subcutaneous tissue, but the important thing is it's also going deep into the fat, even the muscle layers, the facial layers. So we have also the necrotizing necrotizing fasciitis. So can you see this patient? This is actually a photograph of a same periorbital mucormycosis where the patient had suffered from a RTA, road traffic accident, with the soil in, contamination. Now, as sir told you, that actually it is a very old disease, and even this orbital mucormycosis video is covered in my previous app also. But the thing is that it has suddenly increased because, you know, this fungus is ubiquitous. It is present everywhere. It is present in animal matter. It is present in plant matter, animal feces. It is present in dead and decaying matter. But why suddenly we have more cases? The thing is that the immunity is getting weak. So usually the normal patients also get inhalation of these spores. What are the important routes? So we have inhalation, we have ingestion, we have skin contact, we can have direct inoculation. But the problem is that if a person is having normal immunity, he or she will not develop this disease. He has normal phagocytosis. The problem with the COVID patients, the problem with the diabetic patients having ketoacidosis, neutropenia, and all these things is that their immune system is weak. They do not have that immunity to fight against this infection, and that is the reason why this infection is creeping in more. It's not a new infection like the coronavirus. Okay, and as sir rightly told you, that we have to keep a very, very high index of suspicion, because, you know, normally when the patient comes with the epistaxis, nasal stuffiness, some kind of nasal discharge, so we always think about rhinitis, we think about simple sinusitis, and we are starting with the treatment with the antibiotics, NSAIDs and all, and basically we are missing the finding. So obviously if you are missing the finding, you are not giving the antifungals, the treatment is not complete, and the patient will come in the worst stage next. So what are the specimens that we are going to examine? We are going to examine the nasal mucosa, oral mucosa. You have to send for the microbiological evaluation. And we know that because this is, you know, non-septate fungus, which is branched at the obtuse angle. So we can also do the KOH mounts. We can also do the KOH mounts. As sir has already told you about these investigations, so side by side, we are sending this for so many stains. We have pap stain, we have gram stain, and it is said that they are not the stains of choice. So there is no particular stain, one stain that I can say that this is the investigation of choice. But yes, you can use the multiple stains according to the need. We can use the Calcoflow White, we can use the GMS, we can use HNE, we have past staining, and they say that side by side give some tissue for the culture also. For the culture, what we are using is your Sabharaud agar without the cyclohexamide. Again, they are not diagnostic. Now, this is again a very interesting fact that if you are getting even the positive cultures are not diagnostic. So this is surprising. Why? Because it is very, very commonly present as a laboratory contaminant. So negative ones are diagnostic, but the positive ones are not diagnostic. And what is the finding that you are going to get? So very typically, we are getting the finding of thrombosing arthritis with the vessel wall invaded with the fungal hyphae. And an important thing to be noted here that the veins are spared. So these are the things, again, that could be asked in your MCQ, because nowadays, even INICET pattern questions could be asked. You do not know exactly what will be the exact pattern of the questions. We know that more of the clinical questions will be asked. So every line has to be important. The sir has told you that angio invasion is very, very important. Vessel wall is invaded. The type of hyphae, the type of discharge, the eschar formation, what are the important stains, what are the important organs, and veins are spared here. You can see lot of areas of necrosis with hemorrhage also. And that is the reason why debridement is important. Now, debride, when you are debriding and the tissue is necrosed, obviously you will not get bleeding. So how will you get to know that up to what area you have to debride? So the thing is that the moment bleeding starts, because if you are reaching to the normal tissue, the bleeding will start. So that will be probably your end point of the surgical debridement. And you get a very typical kind of appearance here that is called as a crinkled cellophane appearance. That should not be confused with the septations. Again, an important thing, they can ask you that this is your crinkled cellophane appearance that you are getting. Now, when we are doing the staining, HNE staining, and the past staining. It is something like this, what the view that we are getting. And though the elaborate videos have been given to you on its microscopy in the microbiology, you can remember that these are the studies that are taking minimum of 4 to 5 days. So you have to send these for initial stainings. Now, we also have availability of imaging studies. As you know, nowadays, no examination and no clinical case discussion is complete without imaging. So obviously, we have the CT option, we have got the MRI. But the thing is that the findings that we are getting here are very, very subtle and they're non-specific. So basically, the diagnosis is clinical. We are not based on the imaging for the diagnosis, but yes, we can use it for monitoring. We can use it as the prognostic also. So you can see that we have features of sinusitis on CT scan. Sir, what do you say? Do we really incline upon CT and MRI for the diagnosis of the sinusitis and involvement of the nasal mucosa?
Yes, it is a must.
It is a must.
Yeah. So diagnosis based on three things.
Yes, sir.
You have to do three things: endoscopy.
Yes, sir.
A biopsy for staining.
Yes, sir.
And gadolinium MRI.
So, sir, can't we be sure that it's a sinusitis without imaging? We have to confirm it, or the diagnosis is made only after imaging?
No, you. It depends. If the endoscopy shows you the involved tissue in the nasal cavity.
Yes, sir.
But you cannot see sinuses inside the sinus with endoscope.
Okay.
And that's only one CT scan where there is a disease behind the maxilla also. So these areas cannot be seen on endoscope, and therefore you may have to go for scans. One, at least, if not MRI, at least CT scan.
Okay. So CT scan is useful. Yes, for the diagnosis, and it's also useful for the preoperative planning, because if the areas are not visible otherwise, then we cannot plan that how to go for the surgery then.
If you operate without doing a CT, at least a CT scan, maybe yes. MRI, it's almost like a crime. You have to have.
Yes. So these are the things that you are going to see on the CT scan. You can see the sinusitis. We have mucosal thickening, signs of necrosis. And a very important thing is your thrombosis of the superior ophthalmic vein. And I want to emphasize this fact, because you know a similar thing that you get in proptosis is also your keratico-cavernous fistula. So in keratico-cavernous fistula, if you remember, there also we had done one integrated lecture with the radio faculty. So we told you that whenever the proptosis is coming with the PCB, P for the pulsatile proptosis, C for chemosis, and B for Bru. So there you were getting the dilatation of superior ophthalmic vein. So don't confuse here. You are not getting PCB, but you are getting all the other features here. Proptosis hai, but not the pulsatile. You do not have Bru, but you have chemosis, you have optic disc congestion, you have ophthalmoplegia, you have fever, Wichels and Rigers. But here you are not getting dilatation of the superior ophthalmic vein. You are getting the thrombosis of superior ophthalmic vein. Then we can do the PET scan also. It is also a useful tool. But the thing is that you will have to see the cost benefit ratio also. You will have to see the affordability. And if it's very, very urgent, obviously we have to go for. But we cannot say that it's a baseline investigation and a must. But CT scan, as the sir is also telling, that CT scan has to be done in maximum of the cases. So the management, yes. Now this is a drastic and dramatic thing, because treatment is not 100% foolproof, and we have got a lot of mortality. What do you say, sir, about the cases of mortality, sir?
Once it crosses the nasal cavity in orbit into the cranial cavity,
yes,
then,
sir,
the chances of death are extremely, extremely high. I can tell you that anybody who has come with cranial involvement,
yes, sir,
would not be able to save those patients. Most of
so
them.
So normally we have high mortality if the person is already involved the cerebral part.
Yeah. Yes.
So they say that it is having more than 50% mortality. So it is just an emergency. Means as soon as you see the patient, you have to start. And they always say that involvement of an infectious disease specialist is mandatory in the management of this patient, because this is one infection which has multi-system involvement. So they always feel it better and comfortable that if one infectious disease specialist is always involved in this management of this disease. So we have got the antifungals. What are the antifungals that are commonly used? So we have got many antifungals, but the two antifungals that we are basically relying for the treatment is the amphotericin B, and then we have got the posaconazole. So if you see, we have also latest guidelines from the AIIMS Rishikesh, how to start with the treatment. And they have clearly said that the first choice will be your amphotericin B, especially the liposomal complexes. And we have to start with the intravenous amphotericin B, and the preferably will be your lipid complexes. And only the second choice we will keep as the posaconazole. So if you see this, this is the regimen that they have given, the possible or the proven rhinoorbitocerebral mucormycosis. So we can go for the urgent surgical debridement and obviously the glycemic control, because diabetic ketoacidosis is the most important risk factor. We start with 1 to 1.5 milligram of injection amphotericin B. Along with this, we can also use the injection liposomal amphotericin B. So this is 5 to 10 milligram per kg per day. And if there is an intracranial involvement, which is certainly a very, very bad prognostic factor, then we give the 10 milligram per kg. Now, this is when we already have the proven case of rhinoorbitocerebral mucormycosis. For the initial treatment, we will refer to Sir. Sir, please tell us the involvement when there is involvement of only the rhino part.
The first thing that we always start with, again, liposomal amphotericin B. And as you rightly said, if only the nasal cavity is involved, nose and sinuses, then the dose is less than 5 milligram per kg per day.
Yes.
Yeah, less than 5. So it could be 1, 1.5, but we don't cross 5 milligram. The moment it goes to the orbital cavity, we increase it to more than 5, between 5 and 10. And once it crosses into the cranial cavity, then we give 10 milligrams per kg body weight per day. Right. Now, why lysosomal amphotericin B? For two things. A, it is more penetrative into the fungus. B, it is more effective. And also, it has less toxicity. So it gives all the three advantages if you take this particular combination, which is lysosomal amphotericin B, compared to the plain like amphotericin B. A, it is more penetrative. B, it is more effective. And C, it is less, it causes less toxicity.
Less toxicity is also there.
And because, this is, yeah, please. And this is to be mixed in 200 milligram dextrose solution and infused very slowly. Now, when I say that in this patient, this amphotericin B should be mixed in 200 ml of dextrose solution infused very slowly, does it ring something in your minds, students? See, this patient is already diabetic, and that's why they have this problem. And if you infuse dextrose, then you know what's going to happen. The glucose level is going to increase in the body, and that can make the condition worse. And that's why when you mix this amphotericin B in glucose, and then you have to neutralize with insulin. You have to also put insulin, neutralize the glucose part, and then infuse it. So this is a very important thing that you have to keep in your mind, that how do you give this amphotericin B? If they want to really make a very difficult question, now everybody knows that amphotericin B is the main drug, and most of you know the dose. Please remember the dose, less than 5 milligram for nasal cavity, 5 to 10 for orbital cavity, and 10 is for clinical. This dose is important. And how do you give it? That's very important. If they want to really make a very difficult question, how do you infuse it? And then if you say that choice could be amphotericin B alone, amphotericin plus 200 ml dextrose, amphotericin plus 200 ml dextrose plus neutralize with insulin. So that's the best answer. You have to neutralize with insulin and then infuse slowly over a period of time. And this is given for a long period of time, minimum 10 days to 2 weeks. And depending on the response, we may have to continue further also. Now, there are other antifungals like one posaconazole, we have already mentioned that. Yes. So this is given to patients in patients where amphotericin B is either contraindicated or it is not tolerated. Like people who have kidney diseases, you cannot give amphotericin B because we all know amphotericin B has a high nephrotoxicity. And if the patient is already on, is already having some kind of a kidney disease, you cannot give this drug. And these are the patients where you have start isavuconazole, one of the drugs. So this is a substitute in these patients. Or once you start enfortrin B, and because you have to check the kidney function test, and if you see that creatinine level is rising very high, very fast, then you know for sure that this is going, this is creating a problem in the kidneys. Now you cannot continue this drug now. So you have to stop this and then replace with posaconazole. So that's another indication where the drug is not tolerated by the patient. And the third indication of posaconazole is when you want to continue for a long, as a, you know, continuation therapy. So suppose you give enfortrin B for 2 weeks and you think that you should not continue for beyond that because it has a lot of toxicity, then if you want to continue the antifungal for say another 2 weeks or 1 month, then we take a less toxic drug like posaconazole. So if you ask me what are the three indications of posaconazole in these patients, A, patient who have kidney diseases where you cannot give enfortrin B, B, patient who cannot tolerate enfortrin B because they start having, how do you know? The first thing is creatinine levels start rising, and C, as a continuation therapy. These are the three indications for posaconazole in this patient. Now, this is the medicinal part. This is the only important medicine that you have to give. But most important thing is, along with the medicine, you have to do the debridement. Please keep this sentence in your mind, debridement of the involved tissue. That means every part of the tissue that has been involved has to be removed surgically. Debridement means debridement of the involved tissue. And the surgery of choice is FES, functional endoscopic sinus surgery. We know about FES so well, right? Now, whenever you do FES, if FES is an endoscopic surgery, it's a very advanced surgery, but it is a very huge limitation. One is just above the nasal cavity is the cranial cavity, and just lateral to the nasal cavity is the orbital cavity. So orbital damage and the cranial damage during FES is very, very high, and there's an anterior ethmoidal artery also. And that's why whenever we do FES for any simple polyps, simple rhinosinusitis, when you do FES, we always underperform, underdo the surgery. That means we do less than what is required. Mucormycosis is the only nasal disease where when you do FES, you overdo the surgery. You do more than what is required. You go ahead and remove extra tissue also. And the idea is that you are not going to leave any doubtful tissue behind. Because if you leave even a little bit of doubtful tissue behind, then that may flare up and then it may spread to the orbit of the cranial cavity. And I told you, once it is in the cranial cavity, the chances of saving the patient is very, very dim, very remote chances that you'll be able to save this patient. So you cannot take chances. And that's why the follow-up is very important. After you do the surgery, the follow-up part is very, very important. You have to examine the nose second day, third day, fourth day, for every day for 10 days and 2 weeks. And when you do the re-examination and you have any doubts, maybe there is some tissue left there, you are not very sure whether you have been able to remove, like a doubtful tissue, then what do? You go ahead and do a revision surgery. You don't wait. No, in this case, you don't wait. You have, when in doubt, operate. Even if you have to do 2 times, 3 times, 4 times, you'll not believe this. This is my experience with when I was in Safdarjung Hospital. There was this young diabetic with mucormycosis. We operated on this patient, very nice surgery. And next day when we came for follow-up, what is wrong? And when we examined this patient, we felt maybe we have not been able to remove the entire tissue, doubt was. So we took him up to the OPD the same day, OT, and we re-operated the second day. Third day, again, when we came for the round, again, we thought, So this way, in 10 days, this patient, 10 days or 12 days, this patient was operated 5 times. Can you imagine 5 times, same surgery? Now, patient may be thinking, yeah, doctor, beyakuf hai, kya kar raha? But that's not important. What is important is that you cannot, what I'm trying to highlight is that in this case, you cannot leave any tissue behind. And that's why follow-up is very important. When you, the patient comes for follow-up, when you examine, you must be able to see the entire nasal cavity and the sinus cavity. If any, every nook and corner should be able to be seen with your endoscope or even with a naked eye. And that's why initially also, when you do your first surgery, we do a very wide clearance of the disease. Usually, you know that. What is the main advantage of functional endoscopic sinus surgery? It's a tunnel surgery. You know, it's like a tunnel. You remove a very limited tissue, tissue damage is not much, and you only remove the involved tissue, involved area, and most of the tissue is undisturbed. But here is one disease where you remove everything. Okay, but the tissue is not involved, but you still remove the tissue because the disease is behind that area. Remember that image I've shown you where the disease lies behind the maxilla. Now, this is a patient where you have to remove the posterior wall of the maxilla also. Although the posterior wall is healthy, but you remove the posterior wall of the maxilla. Why? Because for post-op, not for disease, for post-op examination. When the patient comes for post-op examination, you can see this area very nicely and be sure that the disease has been removed completely and entirely. Nothing is left behind. Now, this word that I say, that debridement of the involved tissue. Now, what might come to your mind? What if orbit is involved? What is cranial cavity is involved? Now, if the orbit is involved, you have to remove the orbit. That's what it means. Now, this part, Dr. Neha will tell you that when the patient comes with the orbital involvement, we refer the patient to the ophthalmologist and they carry on the further treatment. So, Dr. Neha, over to you.
Thank you, sir. So, if the patient is coming to us with the wide orbital involvement and we know the necrotic nature of this disease, mostly we have to do the wide local excision. So, we have to actually decrease the fungal burden. I have to do the wide local excision, and I've already told you that how to do that excision. We, and sir has beautifully told you that in I think 10 to 12 days, they had operated 5 to 6 times. So, we have to actually remove every bit of that necrosed tissue, and you have to wait till the normal tissue comes. You can see the bleeding. If there is a normal tissue, then bleeding will start. But what happens sometimes, you know, you are not able to remove that. So we have to do the orbital exanteration. So here I will tell you that, see, there are three destructive procedures that we are doing. You already know about evisceration and enucleation. Evisceration, that means you are removing just the viscera. So sclera is there. One is enucleation, where you are removing the whole of the eyeball along with a part of optic nerve. But here the orbit is involved and whole of the orbital tissues are involved. So what we have to do is we have to remove whole of the orbital tissues. We have to empty out the orbital cavity. That is called as the orbital exanteration, one of the very, very important in absolute indications of the orbital exanteration. You must have seen so many cases where we are doing the evisceration, we are doing the enucleation, we have malignancies, we have endophthalmitis, panophthalmitis. So this is a case where you have to go for the orbital exanteration, and you have to see that repeated, as the sir has already told you, that repeated surgical debridement is necessary in many of the cases. And even you can take the help of the imaging studies to find out what is the extent of the tissues. And exanteration should be carried out in the presence of the actively inflamed orbit with a blind eye and the advanced involvement of the orbit. So you don't have to think twice, because if you remember, I always tell you that you have to follow the order, that we have to save the life, then we have to save the eye, and then we have to save the vision. So always follow this order. This should be your preference goal. And you know, it's a locally invasive disease and mortality is very, very high. So we do not think twice before doing this kind of procedure. Do the orbital, this is anteration. And sometimes what happens that even the decompression surgeries has to be done. So that actually depends upon the individual case. But yes, orbital exanteration is required whenever we have the orbital involvement.
Hyperbaric oxygen, as the name tells you, the oxygen is given in higher concentration to the nose. Now, one of the things I told you, if you remember, in the beginning, it's an NJ-invasive fungus, therefore it blocks the blood vessels, causes ischemia, and that is what leads to the necrosis. So when you give a high concentration oxygen with a high pressure, this is hyperbaric oxygen, is a chamber. The patient is placed in a chamber where the oxygen is given a high concentration at high pressure. Concentration is also high, the pressure is also high, both are high. So that's hyperbaric. Now, what it does is, even if the blood vessels are compromised, but the whatever little bit of air, the blood that is flowing, it is full of air, oxygen. So the tissue will receive a high concentration of oxygen, and therefore the chances of ischemia and necrosis is much lesser. So that's how this hyperbaric oxygen functions. Rest, you can take over and talk about this, Dr. Neha.
So we have come over and seen how the involvement of the mucor mycosis starts right from the sinusitis, the nasal discharge, epistaxis, reaching up to the orbit and having wide range of presentations along with the cerebral involvement as the poor prognostic factor. And we have also talked about the treatment aspects, but never to mention that prevention is always better than cure. So we know that preventive measures should be taken to all the population which is at risk. We have already discussed about the high risk factors. Diabetes is not that uncommon nowadays, and we have lot many patients who are COVID positive, who are diabetic with ketoacidosis and malignancies. So obviously all these people should be given the preventive measures. All those patients who are having the transplants or who are having the hematological malignancies, we can start these drugs as the prophylaxis, because you know you should cannot take a chance, especially when we know that the risk of the mortality is so high. It's more than 50%. So more than 50% means something. But yes, you have to see the risk benefit ratio, because we have the likely emergence of the resistant species as well as the possibility of drug toxicity. So it is both ways. It's a double-edged sword. You have to take care of the patients who are at risk. Side by side, intensive monitoring has to be done. There's a lot many toxicities that could be occurring. We are also fearful about the resistant species. So taking into consideration that we have got a filter of those patients who are at high risk, and not every patient is actually having this mucor mycosis, the preventive measures can be concentrated to these patients. What do you say, sir?
Yeah, I want to say something else, also add this. In the prevention, now, why suddenly mucor mycosis has become so common? Now, one, of course, is that patients are immunocompromised because of diabetes and steroids, because the steroids in this second wave, especially, has been continued, starts very early and continues for a long duration. So really that one. Now, but where does the fungus come from? Although Dr. Nia beautifully told you that it comes from the decay matter, from the cow dungs on the in the mud, in the street, it's everywhere. But now it is transmitting from patient to patient. And many of these patients who have been using these appliances, they use face masks, they use the oxygen tubes. It is transmitting from there. So if you use a simple face mask, and if you use over a period of time, this face mask gets infected. Suppose you use a simple face mask, let's say this one. You use this and you use this for 2 weeks, suppose. So it may get infected, and then it may transmit inside when you get into it. So A, you have to clean these things. And second, when the patient gets admitted to the ICUs, those oxygen masks. Now, oxygen masks, these are the ones that get infected to one patient and they go on to the other patient. And that's why when you change this mask, you have to clean or sterilize them properly. And the problem is, because there's so many patients now, you don't have masks, where do you have time to clean them? So this is one thing, you have to clean the oxygen mask properly before you use it for another patient. Also, if you use the same face mask or oxygen mask for the same patient over a period of time, 2-3 weeks, if you have to use, then make sure that you clean after every few days, 5 days, 6 days, you clean it. You cannot use the face mask continuously in the same patient also. You might think, ek patient mein kya farak padta? No, you have to clean it because these are the ones that are carrying the infection. Third thing, you must know that oxygen passes through the water. There's a bottle, the oxygen passes through the water. Where does the water come from? Most of this water that we use for these oxygen cylinders are the tap water. Or tap water upar tanks hi aata. These tanks have been there for ages. They have not been cleaned, and there are so many pathogens, this fungus, everything is there. So you cannot use this tap water. This is a very, very important point. You cannot use a tap water in the oxygen cylinder. You have to use a sterile water. Okay. And that water has to be changed frequently. Almost every day you have to change that water. This is very important in prevention. And better than water in that oxygen tank, if you can use saline. Saline, because normal saline you can use. We all know fungus does not grow very well in saline. So if you use saline water instead of even sterile water, that is even better. So these are the things what we mean by prevention, that control the diabetes, make sure that you do not give steroids for a long duration of time. Don't use the same face mask and oxygen mask over a long period of time. Don't use over different patients without cleaning them. Use sterilized water or not from the tap water, and use saline water. These are the things that are going to prevent. And high index of suspicion is, of course, always there. These are the things which we mean by prevention. Okay. Dr. Neha?
Yes, sir. So, golden points, I think these are the things that one must take care of, because treatment is not that important. Prevention is always more important, and these are small things by which we can prevent this. I think sir has all rightly mentioned that tanks are not clean. So if you are using the overhead tank water in the oxygen supply, so obviously there is a high risk that the patients can get this mucormycosis. And sir, one thing more I wanted to ask you, that there was a question from a student that because the most common mode of entry, one of the common entries is the inhalational. So inhalation of the spores is causing. So can this have a communicability from one person to other? If a person is already having the mucormycosis, can it be transmitted to the other one?
No, it does not go from air. It does not go through the aerosols. It is touch. Mask can transmit. It gets inhalated on the mask, and from mask it can go. But like if I have mucormycosis, I'm talking to you, sitting in front of me, it will not get transmitted. No, it doesn't.
So fomite transfer is there, but air transfer is not there.
Not there, right.
Yes. So I think we have come up end of the discussion, and hope this give you a beautiful and clear insight about the rhino or bito-cerebral mucormycosis. We hope to bring more integrated sessions in future in front of you, so that you can have the real-time clinical case scenarios that we are going to expect in your NEET PG 2021. And we hope that we will be bringing more and more sessions. Please give your feedback. And also tell me that what are the other topics that you like me to make the integrated lectures. And I promise you to bring even more important one, and even sir ko bhi hum dobara laayenge. Sir, we will definitely want that you come again, because students definitely ENT ke aur topics chahte hain, integrated sessions ke, and we will come again with the integrated lecture of ENT.
Really a pleasure, Dr. Neha.
So thank you so much, sir. Thank you, students.
Thank you so much.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you.